Have you ever seen a person trying to use a thing for a purpose other than what that thing was designed for? Well, let me tell you a story about something like that. So as we've been in quarantine, we've been trying to find different ways to keep our son Noah engaged and entertained. And recently he's been really interested in dinosaurs. He's got all these little plastic dinosaurs that he likes to play with, and he matches them up to pictures in a book, and it's been great. But we wanted to do something else. So Becca found an activity on Pinterest or something like that where you take the little plastic dinosaur and you stick it inside an Easter egg, plug up the holes, and fill the Easter egg with water, and then you let it freeze. And then after you've frozen the water and the dinosaur in the egg, you pull it out and you can set the egg on the concrete and bang it and you know, crack it open like a paleontologist or something like that. So we did that. We got one of the little plastic dinosaurs, we stuck it in the egg, we put water in it, and we put it in the freezer to freeze. And then we got it out, and we took it outside and told Noah, hey, we're going to do this activity. But in order to break it open, you need like a hammer or something like that. And I didn't think it was a great idea to give a two-year-old boy a real hammer. So instead, I gave him a meat tenderizer. I don't know if you've ever seen a meat tenderizer, but it's smaller. It kind of looks like a hammer, but most importantly, it's much lighter. And so I thought that would be a little bit safer for him to use. But it was hilarious to me. I know what a meat tenderizer is for, to have Noah out in the back banging on a block of ice, trying to get into, retrieve his little plastic dinosaur. It was hilarious. He was using a tool for something other than what it was designed for. So why do I mention that? Well, I think this is actually a way that a lot of us treat the Bible. We like to treat it as a guidebook or a roadmap to life. We want it to give us advice on how to date, maybe who to date. I don't know if you're one of those people that opens the Bible up and hope that the person's name will be sitting there. We look for it to give us advice on how to get ahead in life or how to find happiness. Really, we want to make the Bible all about us. And it is true that the Bible includes incredible truth, and it does have a whole lot of advice on how to live life, but the Bible isn't first and foremost about you and me. It's about God. The Bible is the story of God's revelation of himself. It's about God coming to the world to show us what he's like and how to live in a relationship with him. And as you may have noticed, as you move through the story of the Bible, God very slowly reveals parts of himself. Over a very long period of time, God is showing himself, his character, his love, his attributes, his desires, his person to his people. And just like human relationships, by the way, God's relationship with people develops slowly. And the more that you get to know a person, the more that you can experience joy and love in that relationship. But it takes time. So I don't know if you've ever met somebody who wanted to sit you down and tell you everything about themselves. And if you did, you probably didn't become their friends, because that's weird, right? That's deep, vibrant relationships take time. Over time, you slowly learn about a person. You don't go from acquaintances to best friends in a moment. It takes time. The same is true of God. So the scripture is the story of God making himself known to his creation, ultimately leading to God making himself known in the person, in the human being of Jesus. But along the way, from the beginning of the scriptures to its culmination in Jesus, there are a few great important moments where God peels away some of the mystery, allowing us to see more clearly who he is. So the passage that we're going to be moving through these next couple of weeks, it is one of those great important moments, which is why I want to move through it slowly and take our time to get through it. So just as a reminder, I want to read the passage again. This is in Exodus 34, verses 5 through 7. And remember, this is the renewing of the covenant between God and his people after their failure with the golden calf at Sinai. And Moses had just asked God to reveal to him his ways and reveal to him his glory. And God said, no, actually, I'm going to proclaim my name to you. This is what it says, Exodus 34, beginning in verse 5. The Lord descended in a cloud and stood with him there and proclaimed the name of the Lord. And this is the Lord speaking. The Lord passed before him and proclaimed, the Lord, a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness, keeping steadfast love for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, but who will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children and the children's children to the third and fourth generation. Now, what I want to talk to you today about today is just the first word, or in English, it's the first two words. It's the Lord, right? Now, most of your Bibles probably have that word Lord written in all caps, or a big cap and then small caps. And you probably know that when we see all Lord in all caps, it's the way English translators indicate to us this is a very special name for God. It's the personal covenant name between God and his people. But what's interesting is this isn't revealed till much later in the story of God, right? In fact, when God first shows up on the first page of the Bible, he is referred to in really general terms, right? Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, you probably know it, says, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth." And the word that we translate God is the Hebrew word Elohim. Now, Elohim isn't a name. It's a title. Basically, it just means divine being. Actually, it's not a very unique way of referring to God. A lot of characters in the Bible are called Elohim, including angels, and even evil divine beings are called Elohim. It's the context which lets you know whether we're talking about the one true God or something different. So it's kind of like our English word dad, right? When I say the word dad, I can be referring to many different dads or one dad in particular. So at the very beginning of Scripture, we're given this really general, kind of impersonal name for God, or a way of referring to God. It's not a name, it's a title. All we know is that there is a God who created the heavens and the earth. We have to wait until later in the story to know more about him. And it isn't until much later in the story that God actually reveals his name. That happens early in Moses' story, back in Exodus chapter 3. And if you remember, that's the moment when Moses, who's been tending sheep in the desert now for 40 years after being chased out of Egypt, suddenly encounters God in a burning bush. This is what it says in Exodus chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. "Now Moses was pasturing the flock of his father-in-law, Jethro, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the west side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. The angel of the Lord appeared to him in a blazing fire in the midst of a bush, and he looked, and behold, the bush was burning with fire, yet it was not consumed. So Moses said, 'I must turn aside now and see this marvelous sight, why the bush is not burned up.' When the Lord saw that he turned aside to look, God called to him out of the midst of the bush and said, 'Moses, Moses.' And he said, 'Here I am.' Then he said, 'Do not come near here. Remove your sandals from your feet, for this is the place on which you're standing is holy ground.' And he also said, 'I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. Then Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. So, and then after that, God says to Moses, 'I want you, Moses, to go into Egypt and bring my people who are in slavery out of Egypt. And I'm about to put all of that slavery to an end, and I'm sending you to them, and your God is coming with you. I'm going to be with you, and I'm going to bring my people out of Egypt.' But then in verse 13 of chapter 3, Moses says, Then Moses said to the Lord, 'Behold, I am going to the sons of Israel, and I will say to them, The God of your fathers has sent me to you. Now they may say to me, What is his name? What shall I tell them?'" Now, what's interesting, the question that Moses asks, "What is your name?" That's a close translation, but in English you actually miss some of the significance of the question. Moses isn't asking an acquaintance what mix of syllables he's known by, right? He isn't just looking for John or Steve or Bill. More literally, Moses is asking God, "What is the significance of your name?" You see, so it's more than just, "Hi, I'm Moses, what should I call you?" This is, "Who are you? What are you like?" Because remember, like we talked about last week, in ancient cultures, your name is your identity. It says a lot more about you than what we call you. And we also need to remember that Moses was familiar with dozens or even hundreds of gods of the Egyptians, the gods that the Egyptians worshipped, the god of the sun, the god of the moon, the god of the Nile River, etc. So when Moses goes to the people enslaved in Egypt and he says, "God is coming to get you," he's expecting them to say, "Great, which one?" Right? So because of that, he's asking for more detail from God. And it's in an answer to this question that we get those famous words in Exodus 3, verse 14. God said to Moses, "I am who I am." And he said, "Thus shall you say to the sons of Israel, I am has sent me to you." So, I am who I am. What a strange way to answer Moses' question. If you asked me to tell you something about myself and I responded to you with "I am," you would say, "You are a what," right? And you can answer that question about that, about me, by the way. I'm a son, I'm a father, I'm a pastor, I'm short, right? I'm definable. You can define me. But what about God? Can you define God? Moses is saying, God, can you tell me something about yourself? What are you like? What is your significance? And God simply responds by saying, I am. So when God says, I am who I am, a lot of people make a mistake and see this is where God's revealing his name. It's not. Here, God is actually answering Moses' second question. See, Moses had asked, how can I make them believe that it's you? How can I make your people in Egypt believe that this is you, the God of their fathers? And God is saying to him, just tell them it's me, right? So God is also saying, look, Moses, you can't use any name to describe me. Human language has no one word that can contain all that I am. I am my own definition. I am the God who exists. You can't put me into a box. You can't simply describe me. I am the God who is. So there's a New Testament scholar named Scott McKnight, and he's also an author. And he used to teach a course at Northern Baptist Theological Seminary in Illinois. And at the beginning of his course, he would give his students two surveys. The first survey asked questions about the students. What did they like? What do they dislike? What do they believe in? And the second question asked those same questions, but about Jesus. And after collecting those two surveys, he would match the students' answers about themselves to their answers about Jesus. And he found that 90% of the time, the answers to the questions were exactly the same. Now let that sink in for a moment. As human beings, we have this terrible tendency to remake God in our image. And we're especially good at doing this in church. We like to pick and choose bits of scripture that talk about the traits of God that we like, but we ignore the parts that talk about the traits of God that are uncomfortable for us. So we create in our minds a God who agrees with us on everything. He thinks and he acts just like us. He cares about the same things that we care about, and he's especially forgiving of our disobedience. In fact, our sin is barely worth mentioning. Beware if you find yourself believing in a God who agrees with you and always excuses your sin. You might worship a God, but that's not the God of the Bible. Actually, you might have more in common with the Egyptians, the Canaanites, or the Romans who worshiped gods that reflected their own sinful desires. It is not our right to define who God is, what he is like, and what he cares about. God alone reserves the right to define himself. So in Hebrew, I am who I am is Echye Asher Echye. Right? You have to get some phlegm in your voice when you speak Hebrew. But another way of translating that, Echye Asher Echye, is whatever I am, I will be. In other words, whatever God is like, he will be like that consistently. He doesn't change. Now, that's not true of human beings. You and I change constantly, right? So I might be nice to you today, but tomorrow, if Judah keeps me up all night and I don't get any rest, I'll probably be mean because I'll be grumpy. See, we change based on circumstances, emotions, even over time. The person that I am today is not the same person that I was when I was your age. So hopefully I've grown out of some of my immature ways, but it's also probably true that unattractive parts of my personality have hardened over time and maybe even gotten worse. But God isn't like that. He can't be changed by opinions. He can't be changed by our ignoring parts of his character. He doesn't change over time, and he can't be changed by our actions. And that's really good news. So many chapters and many, many years later, in Exodus 34, God gave Moses an even fuller picture of his person and his character. He's not just saying, I am anymore. I am who I am. He actually is defining himself, right? Because God himself reserves the right to define who he is. This is what he says. Remember, the Lord, a God gracious, merciful and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness, keeping steadfast love for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, but by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children and the children's children to the third and fourth generation. So, God was gracious and merciful, and that hasn't changed. God was slow to anger, and that hasn't changed. God was abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness, and that hasn't changed. God is forgiving, and that hasn't changed. And yes, I know that you have questions about the part about punishing children. We'll get there in a few weeks. It's not what you think, and it's actually really good. But here's what I want you to see. The God who revealed himself to Moses, who revealed his name in the cloud on that mountain as merciful, gracious, slow to anger, and forgiving, is the same God that you and I worship today. And speaking of God's name, by the way, what is God's name? We actually don't get it. We actually haven't gotten there yet. So in Exodus 3, in verse 15, God says this. God furthermore said to Moses, "Thus shall you say to the sons of Israel, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and this is my memorial name to all generations." So there you see it. In our English Bible, God's name is the Lord in all caps. And as you already heard me say, the Lord in all caps is a translation of God's name, which in Hebrew we spell YHWH, or Yahweh. Now, Yahweh comes from the Hebrew word haya, like karate, haya, which means he is. And by the way, do you see that? When God says, I am, the word is echye, right? As when he said, I am who I am, it's echye asher echye. But when we say God's name, we say Yahweh, which means he is. So I think that to translate the Lord, Yahweh the Lord, isn't particularly helpful because it's a title and not a name. So most of you guys know that I prefer to be called Cameron, right? I'd rather you just call me by my name. You don't have to call me Pastor Cameron unless that's what your parents want you to do. But imagine if I told you, don't call me Cameron or Pastor Cameron, but just the pastor, right? Do you see how cold and impersonal that is? God has given us his name because he wants us to know it. He wants us to know it because he wants to have a relationship with us. And when we call him by his name, Yahweh, he is, we are agreeing that God is who he says he is. We're saying, I don't decide who God is, God does. And I accept everything that you are, not just the parts of you that I like, but all of you. You are God, I am not, and that's a good thing. So God is a personal being. He's not a force, he's not a formula, he's a person, or three persons, who wants to be known. He has a name, and he wants you to know it. He wants you to know it is him, because he wants you to know everything that he is. In fact, God is so intent on you knowing that he didn't stop his revelation at Sinai, right? In the New Testament, John writes this in the beginning of his biography about Jesus. He says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." And then in verse 14, he says, "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we have seen his glory, glory as the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth." Do you remember what Moses asked, what the question was that Moses asked when God responded by proclaiming his name? In Exodus 34, the original question was, "Show me your ways. Show me your glory." Moses wanted to know God's ways. He wanted to know God's glory, right? Now read verse 14 of John again. "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we saw his glory, glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth." Do you see that? So God couldn't let Moses see his glory because it would kill him, right? But Jesus is the answer to Moses' question. Jesus is the one who shows us the ways and the glory of God, and he came to us so that God could be known. So later, the author of Hebrews says, Jesus is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his nature, and upholds all things by the word of his power. Isn't that amazing? So Moses didn't get an answer to that question, but God's name pointed forward to Jesus, who is the fullness of that answer. You want to see God's glory? Look at Jesus. Whatever God is like, we can see him most clearly in Jesus. Jesus came to earth to live, die, and to be risen again precisely so that we could have a relationship with God. He has a name. He wants you to know it because he wants to know you, and he wants you to know him. And by the way, knowing about God isn't the same as knowing God. There are a lot of people in the world who know a lot about God, right? And we call knowledge about God theology. But God doesn't just want you to know about him. He wants you to know him. God wants a relationship with us. God responds to us. Now, it is true that God is unchanging, right? But one of the great paradoxes of our faith is that our unchanging God sometimes changes his mind. How does that work? I don't know. But Moses is somebody who experienced that. God said, "Okay, Moses, I'm done with these people. I'm going to wipe them out." And Moses said, "No, God, please don't. That's not your type of character. That's not who you are." And God said back to him, "Okay, I won't." That's incredible. It's absolutely incredible. It's a paradox. How does that work? How is God unchanging and yet sometimes he changes his mind? I don't know. We could talk about that all day. But the amazing thing is I want you to see that God is a responsive God. He wants a relationship to you. He can be moved by you. He will respond to you. I don't know how that works, but I know what it is like being in a relationship with a relational God. And it's exciting, it's beautiful, and it's scary being in a relationship with the most unique being in the entire universe. And by the way, that's what you were made for. But here's what I want you to remember today. Our God is Yahweh, which means he is who he is. He is who he says he is. He's not who you think he is. He's not who you wish he is or who you want him to be. If you want to have a relationship with the one true God, we must come to him on his own terms, not my own. You have to let him tell you who he is and not the other way around. And that, by the way, is why we're doing this study. So my encouragement to you, my plea to you is to pay attention. Go on a journey and find out who God is. Don't be tempted to pick and choose parts of God's character based on your feelings and preferences and ignore other parts. Don't worship a God who's a reflection of your image. Instead, get to know the God whose image you reflect. He has a name, and he wants you to know it. Bye, guys.